welcome to another episode of Literary Gladiators, the show where we discuss and debate literature in all of its forms. If it's written work, it's game. Let's meet the panel.
Hello, I'm Larry.
Hi, I'm Erin.
I'm Charlie.
And I'm Josh.
Gee willikers.
Already. Charlie and Larry, you were primarily familiar with them. Erin is back once again after she celebrated Christmas with us. I hope you had a fun time.
Did Santa bring you everything you wanted? Please say yes.
Yes. I got a cat.
Yeah, I remember. I was sneezing the whole way.
That cat sure likes to hop on people's backs.
Like mine.
But otherwise, a few months ago, I put up a poll asking you, the viewers, which Shakespeare play you wanted to see us discuss. And the one that got the most votes was King Lear. So that is going to be what we go over today. It is one of his tragedies. It seems like his tragedies pick up more attention than his comedies. From Juliet, Hamlet, Macbeth. But let's get right into the discussion. First question is, how would you describe King Lear's daughters? What kind of role do each of them play in this play?
If I say that they're unstable, is that going to get me thrown off the house?
It's an opinion, so no.
It's been a very long time since I read it, and I read the whole play in one day because it was a really good play. Mm. But some tell me they were a little, and please, no offense to anybody, that they were a little...
I would probably need help from actually watching a play in order to...
I was told plays are meant to be watched, not read in a book. But still,
I cannot agree more.
Yeah, I feel like it's difficult for high school students especially to engage because the language...
Well, they're too young to engage anyway, so...
The language is so old, the actors need to act it out with the proper enunciation and proper
facial expressions
and...
Body language.
For them to understand, oh, that line is a funny line, that line means this, what I mean?
And Shakespeare really does. I was reading something else, either we went over, we planned to go over Crucible, where they actually will talk about they'll mention the emotion within the script. With Shakespeare, it's pretty much implied.
Yeah,
and it doesn't, and you also look into, or the fact that the soliloquies, when people are thinking, it's spoken out loud.
Yes.
When
to be or not to be.
Right.
When people are engaged in basic actions,
like,
I'm going to firmly grasp your hand. And express my passion for thee.
Thank you.
And things happen. things actually happen, right?
Mm-hmm.
That are barely... If you're not paying very close attention while you're reading, you don't even know that like somebody got stabbed or what happened.
Yeah.
Because the action isn't even really written out very well.
Macbeth? Hamlet. I will speak daggers, but use none.
Oh.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, we're going to, Some high school students like daggers. Some people don't even know what a dagger is. Like, what's a dagger? Oh, go in a dictionary, look up dagger.
If it's in a high school, they use it as a vocabulary word.
Yeah.
That's what they do with any.
Yeah, they did that with us.
That, and if your high school teacher is your instructor,
mm-hmm.
like with me. But we're straying away from the
question
at hand. With
which hand?
Let's talk about his daughters, which I would see... I think it's a basic case of genuine versus phony.
Yeah, that's what... I mean, with the phony one, I'm like, a little unstable. The other one, maybe I was
not
a little too...
One, two phony.
Well,
Goneril and Regan were both sugarcoating their feelings for their dad. And once they got power, they came to the conclusion...
Should we break it to him now? Yeah.
Well, really, as soon as Cordelia got done wrong, right, is they pretty much decide right then and there, Dad's unstable, we gotta do something.
Mm-hmm.
But Cordelia, right, she's the only one that is honest.
Mm-hmm.
And by going last
yes,
of the three, that probably hurt her, because if she had gone first, then, you know, maybe the father, you know, Lear would have realized that she's being honest. Then the other two come in with their...
She's the youngest, too. They did it in order of age.
I understand.
Yeah, once his power was away from him and they didn't need him for anything, the treatment of him was completely 180.
At first, it seemed like it was basic, but then it turned into just some... It became very evil. They just came off as being very witch-like.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Especially Goneril. But Regan, too, because Regan followed along with the charade.
Yeah, they were both definitely involved. Regan had no hesitation in jumping on the train.
Mm-hmm. They didn't have trains back then, but they had wagons. But I know what you're trying to say.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, thanks. But yeah, it's kind of split, right? You had those... you have Cordelia kind of representing, like, the positive feminine qualities of, like, you know, forgiveness and honesty and those kinds of things. And then the other two are kind of, you know, the opposite end of that set, right? Where they're, you know, kind of conniving and manipulative. And
what were your thoughts about his daughters, Charlie?
Well, I'm going to have to strongly agree with Larry, you know, with Cordelia, and something with the name Cordelia... To me, that sounds sweet to me. That's a sweet name. You know, just the sound of hearing, oh, hello, Cordelia, you know. It's a cordial, okay? So, I that's just a little bit of a connection I made. But with Goneril and, what was he like? Regan. Okay. Regan, I can understand, you know, but with Goneril, for me, I'm not judging. Please don't, you know, think I'm judging. It's just, you know... I really, you know, I couldn't... It was hard for me to just, you know, follow the sincerity of Goneril, but for Cordelia, can't talk today. Cordelia, I thought she was, you know, the most sincere. She meant what she said. I mean, they kind of sugarcoat in the beginning, but... Or is it, you know...
Goneril and Regan were sugarcoating because they knew that it would help them further advance.
Yeah.
But...
And basically, sugarcoating, you know, and if it's for your father, it's kind of like, Daddy, I love you so much. And this would be today, I hope. Daddy, I love you so very much. Daddy, I'd love to use the new car that we just got. Could I borrow the keys? Now, after he loses his power, Dad, give me the keys now. I gotta go to the party.
Goneril was, I love you more than words can wield the matter.
Yeah.
Dearer than eyesight, space, and liberty, and so on and so forth.
Exactly.
And basically, with all my heart, is what she says.
Mm-hmm. Regan is, I am made of that self-metal as my sister, and prize me at her worth. In my true heart, I find she names my very deed of love.
I found a little bit of a...
Which,
yeah.
And again, she's implying that she loves her father with all of herself and with everything that she is.
It's over-dramatized.
What's that?
It was over-dramatized.
Oh,
just,
definitely.
Yeah.
Just, and
not
people do that.
Yeah.
They do that all the
I
time.
I just kind of used the car for one night. I had to, you know, Jimmy's having that prom party, you know, after prom party.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and that, of course, like I said, it would be, this is like 16,000... Years later or something. Okay, slight exaggeration.
Well, I mean, yeah, really, the whole play can kind of be seen as a bad episode of the Housewives Wives of New Jersey or something like that. You look at it through that lens.
I don't watch TV.
The behavior of the people in this is ridiculous. It's horrible behavior.
Yeah. Let's move on to the next question about Edgar and Edmund. The other...
they both start with an A, so...
It's King, the Earl of Gloucester's son, so... Do you see importance in Edgar and Edmund's brotherhood and its part in this play?
How are they? Are they the same age? I mean, or is one a few years older or a few years younger?
I want to say, I know that Edmund is the quote-unquote the bastard child.
Yes.
Edgar is
the one that was...
Yeah,
the legitimate child.
The legitimate child.
But
yeah.
Which came first? I don't know.
The chicken or the egg?
I thought it was Edgar, but...
Maybe.
I feel like it would make sense, though, because first you have an unwed child, then you get married, and you have a legit child,
yeah.
Right?
That would
or
be
you
the
could
unless he had an affair.
Oh, wait, was it infidelity? Because aren't there points in the play where he's, like, embarrassed, like, oh, yeah,
yes.
I had an affair, here's my bastard. So yeah, it was out of an affair.
Because, the Earl of Gloucester was, he treated Edgar much better because he felt embarrassed about the result of his affair, and thus Edmund felt the way to take revenge would be to forge a letter trying to betray his dad in the words of Edgar.
What I find interesting about that is, I don't know, usually it's like we root for the underdog,
mm-hmm.
and initially I feel like people feel sympathy for Edmund.
I didn't.
But then he becomes the evil one,
yeah.
and the privileged son, the one who everyone loves,
mm-hmm.
is the one we take the side of. So I found that interesting, because usually it's like whoever is the underdog is the one the audience is rooting for, but it's switched.
It's definitely a great deal of irony, but Edmund is doing this outright. That's the first thing he's doing, is forging the letter to betray his brother, and Edgar is just very... He has this live and let live personality to him.
Yeah, and Edmund, I think, is probably the most interesting character for me.
Mm-hmm.
I like his little soliloquy. I want to read it.
Okay, go right ahead.
This is the excellent foppery of the world, that when we are sick in fortune, often the surfeit of our own behavior, we make guilty of our disasters the sun, the moon, and the stars, as if we were villains by necessity, fools by heaven's compulsion, knaves, thieves, and treachers by spherical predominance, drunkards, liars, and adulterers by an enforced obedience of planetary influences, and all that we are evil in by a divine thrusting on. An admirable evasion whoremaster man to lay his goatish disposition to the charge of a star. My father compounded with my mother under the dragon's tail, and my nativity was under Ursum Major, so that it follows I am rough and lecherous. Tut, I should have been that I am, had the maidenness star in the firmament twinkled on my bastardizing. So to me, basically what he's saying there is that he sees the people blaming the gods for their predicaments. Mm-hmm. And he is saying, not me. Mm-hmm. I don't do that. I am a bastard, and I am not a good person. Basically, he's saying, and that all falls on me, and that's what I am. Mm-hmm. And this is just before he starts with his plot to unseat his brother.
And he chooses to go the negative route, when he could very well turn himself around and make make a better example of someone in his circumstance.
And as you said, I agree with both of you, Josh and Josh Larry. I agree with you. I also agree with you, rooting for the underdog. You know, they had sympathy for him. You know, like, it's okay, it's all right, don't worry. You know. I would feel bad for him, but then again, I'm gonna put myself in his shoes, and I'm getting all this comfort, all this consolation. It depends on how I'm being treated by Edmund. If Edmund's treating me now, here's the thing: if Edmund's treating me like dirt under his boots, because they didn't have shoes back then, really, they had mostly boots and sandals and etc. I'm wearing the newest fashion of Uggs right now. I'm just kidding. I have to stop with those tangents. That's a New Year's resolution. yeah, right? 5 minutes. That's like saying I'm going to the gym, which I'm not.
But Charlie, what I was trying to get at...
No, I know.
...is, I think that's the question in the play, right? It's almost like a determinism versus a free will kind of argument.
Yeah. Mm. The fate or free will.
Right, he's denouncing the fate side of it. He's basically saying, I'm willing myself to do this.
Yeah,
that's how I take it, anyway.
No, I know. Mm-hmm. But when you started saying, when you said Ursa Major, the Nativity, religious, going into that aspect, the gods, you know.
These were pagans, right, in this play. These are pagans.
Yeah.
Just to point that out, but go ahead.
Of course. No, I understand, but it's, you know, with the pagans, well, with any religion like that, for me, if I don't know how else to explain it, so I don't want to be blunt. I'm a bastard, okay? So what are you going to do about it? Well, you know, it depends on how I'm treated by my peers or my superiors. If I'm being treated like garbage, I'm not going to be, you know, your biggest, you know, obvious. I'm going to be planning a way to get back at you. I mean, that's just a really bad example, but if I'm being consoled and being told, look, things happen for a reason, you know, it's not your fault, mom and dad did this, or, you know, I mean, I'm going on the fate side. So you're leaning toward the free will?
No, I think it's just...
Or the fate?
I'm not going to presume to know the answer, but...
Oh, no, okay, no.
But I think that Edmund chose the free will.
Oh, so he chose it, yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
I really don't think that... I think somebody that feels the need to settle for their fate...
Yeah.
Is
he trying to cover
really
himself?
Is really thinking incorrectly.
No, I'm not sure about that.
No, because I'm wondering now, I mean...
If it's a negative, if it's a positive... You always want to... take a positive direction in your life.
Absolutely.
You shouldn't feel that you should, because you're in a negative position, you shouldn't feel the need to remain there, because...
Yeah.
Right.
So yes,
that,
now I see what you're doing. Okay. I was a little confused. My fault.
And it's kind of against, I think, our nature to do that.
Mm-hmm. There are people that settle for...
I think they kind of get trapped.
Mm-hmm.
Like Edmund.
In a manipulative kind of way.
Gotcha.
But I don't know if Edmund... was, I don't know. Granted, he chose to go with Goneril, who that really doesn't help matters any.
Yeah,
well, he promised himself to both of them too.
Mm,
you know, I mean, he didn't really decide. I guess he would figure whichever one's left alive at the end of the tragedy.
Love triangle of witches, and that. Speaking of which, the Duke of Albany is an interesting character, because he seems to change from, he breaks away from Goneril. Goneril's message and her desires, and turns against them.
I was thinking, you know, Larry, in addition to what you said, you know, maybe he's doing it, he's trying to comfort himself, because he needs that closure in his life. He's like, well, you know, I mean, hey, if I found out something or something similar to happen to me, you know, it's a good chance I'm either going to, you know, I'm going to try and find comfort in this. You know, I'm going to try and, you know, myself, I would go to the church and say, Father, what do I do? Well, what do you think you should do? Come here and ask for advice? And then if that doesn't work, you know. But being that this is back when, have another.
Yeah, it's a very difficult situation
yeah.
to be in that situation. You know, it can't be pleasant.
I'm sure it's not.
No, I mean... Have you guys seen Game of Thrones?
I don't watch TV.
I'm
flat out saying it. I don't watch
TV. I've heard of Game of Thrones. I'm very familiar with it. I haven't watched an episode or read
it. But yeah, I mean, it deals with this as well, you know, this whole bastardization thing, you know. They're called Snows in that show. Basically, that's kind of the assumed name that they give to bastards because, you know, they can't have the family name.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. But, you know, so that kind of examines this... The life of the bastard in these kinds of times,
yeah.
You know, in a more in-depth way, I'd say.
Gotcha. Yeah.
But
and when I said I have a throne, I mean it. My drum throne.
Okay.
Drummers actually have two thrones. Everyone has one throne they use occasionally. My throne sits behind my drum set.
Mm. Are you referring to the bathroom toilet?
Yes, but that's everyone's throne.
Occasionally?
Oh, it's a joke.
And people use it every day.
Well, yeah. But it's not like...
Oh. Yes,
some regular.
Unless you're watching Game of Thrones on the throne. Anyway, I am not...
Next question.
All right.
Yeah,
let's go to the next question. We're going to go back to Cordelia.
Aww.
Already. Freud argued that Cordelia represents death. Would you agree with Freud's approach, or would you take a different approach? I know Larry and Larry had brought up.
I just looked it up. Just a little bit more detail. About
sometimes a cigar is just a cigar. That's
about his argument.
Yeah, what's his like claims and?
Yeah, well, here's what I have. He asserted that Cordelia symbolized death. Therefore, when the play begins with Lear rejecting his daughter, it can be interpreted as him rejecting death.
This is interesting.
Lear is unwilling to face the finitude, I guess, of his being.
Definitive, I think.
No, is it finitude?
Yeah.
The play's poignant ending scene, where Lear comes to the body of his beloved Cordelia, was of great importance to Freud. In this scene, she causes in Lear a realization of his finitude, or as Freud put it himself, she causes him to make friends with the necessity of dying. Now, it goes on to say that it makes sense that that scene is important, that Cordelia dies, because there's three versions of this story that have been told throughout history, and this is the only one where she dies.
Mm-hmm. But besides the opening and like ending scenes with Lear and Cordelia, I'm trying to like, because if that's a metaphor, then you gotta like lace it through the entire story.
I know Cordelia was trying, and her troops were trying to save him.
So what is, I'm trying to figure out where that would fit in, like the whole her going to war for him, because death wouldn't try to save your life.
Because I don't necessarily, I think that there's a lot, it's a decent argument, but it's not the one that I foresee when looking at this plot.
Yeah, it's interesting, but I'm not sure it stands up in a larger
sense. I don't think so either. I think Freud was pretty much preoccupied with death and sex.
Well, yeah,
that's about
and
the psychology of the ego.
The ego. Oh my god.
But I think with regard to Cordelia, I think that she represents the idea that actions speak louder than words. I think it's simple as that.
Mm-hmm.
And the fact that Goneril and Regan are the are package that's too good to be true, like anything that's being advertised on television.
No, when you actually... But get it into your house.
It's like
it's crap, and it's not working right.
That's seen on TV.
They're like Marvin's Magic Drawing Kit, which is...
is that the...
It looked like this magnificent blackboard where you could apply some wand to, and it comes out with all
when
these colors.
When garlic gloviosa. How's it done? Wait, a wand, you said?
It's more like a writing utensil.
Oh. Well, basically, if it's as seen on TV, no, it's not. Trust me.
Mm-hmm. It's like your Mr. Sticky, where
Mr. Sticky.
It lasts for 2 seconds, and then you got to wash it off, and it still feels very faint. But we're digressing. How do you feel? What kind of role Cordelia has in the play, Erin?
I think she's, like you said, like the real deal. She's just representative of truth, and she's who the reader roots for and connects with the entire time, because she sees things for as they are, she tells it how it is, and she acts on her own ambition and knows what is right, and I'm going to go to war for my dad, even though he disowned me, because he's my dad, and that's
mm-hmm.
She's definitely like the most noble character in the play, I'd say.
Definitely one with great values.
Integrity. She has integrity.
And
exactly.
How she dies for him, which not a lot of not a lot of cases.
She has, and it's rare, because like in these plays, like you said, the women are very, you know, like to the side. They're very props and the wife of the main role, but she is... she's very central, and she's very, she has a lot of self-respect, so much so that she's not going to pretend to put on this false sense of self to act.
She's not
going to
put on
Shakespeare does have some powerful female characters.
Oh, definitely. I'm saying not
Lady
in Shakespeare,
Macbeth.
But in, like, this time period
mm-hmm.
role, definitely.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, like I said at the beginning, I think she represents feminine virtue.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. I think that's what she is. She's loyal, she's compassionate, she's forgiving, she's kind.
Yes.
And she's fierce, you know, and it's mm-hmm. It's everything that her sisters are not.
Mm-hmm. Basically, she's, you know, she's the one that you don't want to mess with. Mm. When you have a family gathering. Okay, everybody, don't make her angry. But I would say, I agree with everything, with what you said about Cordelia. You know, and of course, integrity. She's definitely, you know, she's, you know, I think she's the one daughter of the three that did everything right, that did being a daughter right, as you would, as some people would say. You know, the other two, not so much, but, and of course, being that Mr. King Lear didn't really favor her so much, I guess. Like I said, it's been a really long time since I read the play, and I started it at 11 o'clock at night. I'm like, ah, oh, beautiful. Mm-hmm. I finished it at 1:30.
Yeah, well, just to remind you, Charlie, in the very beginning, he calls her his favorite.
Yeah.
And as soon as she says...
And, and then...
As soon as she says, you know, what she says, it, she will only love him with half his heart, because the rest belongs to who she marries.
Exactly. That's when...
That's when...
The lust... Mm-hmm. The lust.
It all goes to hell.
Yeah, well, yeah. Mm-hmm. But, you know, and then... If I was Lear in this situation, and I'm watching my daughter be put into the ground, you know, for going to war, for me, gee, well, I didn't do such a good job. You know, I should have accepted her. I should have said, good luck.
So you wouldn't have taken off your clothes and dressed yourself in vines and flowers and run around the beach?
Nah, nah. too many, I don't want the neighbors thinking I'm completely crazy.
Yeah. Mm.
Can we also talk about the fact that Shakespeare has dying of a broken heart as just like a valid way for many characters to die?
Yeah.
I find that so interesting because like as like a writer stance, you have an idea of what you want to happen in the end of the book. Mm-hmm. And if you don't have characters to kill him, you're just like, well, I want him to die though. Dies of a broken heart. There we go. Problem solved.
It is all...
There are
like if Shakespeare's stories came out today... They would not survive YouTube criticism at all. Like, I mean, the time frame that it takes a messenger to send a messenger to France and then come back is like, what, 2 hours? You know, on horseback? It's just, it doesn't, none of it works. It doesn't work in the time aspect, as well as other issues like.
But I think with regard to dying from a broken heart, you also have to take into account some of the side effects. Heart failure.
Yeah.
If your stress level goes up so much, it begins. It causes other health problems.
If you have pre-existing heart conditions, mm-hmm. possibly.
Yeah.
Then you just have the more obvious ones of suicide.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Any final thoughts? We didn't bring up.
Did you know Lear rhymes with spear? And don't. Yeah, I know. I was going to make a joke, but I don't want to.
Okay.
You're expecting a joke, I'm not giving it to you. Sorry.
It strikes me as, you know, something worth mentioning that when we did Hamlet, right, the mm-hmm. entire conversation that we had was pretty much centered around that character.
Yeah.
And now here we are talking about King Lear, and we've hardly talked about him at all.
Yeah. Pretty much.
I find that odd.
He's very much a... aging old man who's definitely mentally aging and also physically aging.
I think also he's like a reactive character rather than a proactive character.
Mm-hmm.
He kind of is shuffled around and reacts to the events occurring. Rather, Cordelia is the one who's, and the other characters who are plotting and scheming, those are all the characters.
I would say the main proactive character. Granted, Cordelia is proactive, even though she's not in the play as much.
Yes.
It's Goneril, Regan, Edmund.
Yeah.
I would say Edgar and the Duke of Albany are your forces that are on the side of King Lear.
Mm-hmm.
And also, don't forget, what's his name?
Mm.
What's his name?
Ken,
I think it's
Ken.
Name.
Yeah,
Ken.
Who, he was banished because he agreed with the
with Cordelia.
Cordelia,
he said, "Don't do it."
And,
he said, "Don't don't take, kick her out."
Mm-hmm.
And Lear
and
was
then
like,
he comes back in disguise as Caius.
Yeah.
So, alrighty, do we want to rate this play? Same scale, 0 to 5, and half stars.
Next up,
this bowl.
Yeah, except. Okay.
It's hard. What, based on what?
Whatever your own criteria.
Oh, yeah. Okay. I guess I'll give it a 3 then.
Mm. Okay. I'll give it a 4. Too many characters to keep track of. And unrealistic deaths. Okay.
So the judges do have good scores. let's see. Like I said, I read it in a course of an hour or 2.5 hours, maybe. And, you know, I wanted to read it, and I couldn't put it down. So I'm like, just another few pages. Sun's coming up. More pages. Okay. I'm giving it a 4.5.
Right now, I would say a 4. But I definitely agree with Erin with how there are so many... so many characters to keep track of, and
that was hard to do.
So many unexplainable deaths.
Mind, yeah.
But it's just something that I would need. It would require thought. If I'm comparing it to other things that I've read from him, I still think Macbeth is my favorite thus far, and King Lear is a bit more. I would say.
Is more
Hamlet's a bit better than King Lear, but I think King Lear is better than Romeo and Juliet and some of the weaker plays like Pericles and Cymbeline. But
gotcha.
If you're interested in checking out every play that Shakespeare has written, here is a collection that I got at Barnes & Noble for $7.98.
Really? Good deal.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Most certainly. If you're a Shakespeare enthusiast, you would probably want the individual edition. But I'm not an enthusiast for Shakespeare's plays. I'll read them if I'm discussing them, but this is perfectly suitable for me. And I'll pop it open while I watch the play. I find that to be most helpful. Alrighty then, Erin, did you want to share a poem?
I'm trying to I don't have many things that connect, but on the topic of suicide and slight romanticization of suicide, this one is titled Evelyn. 1947, New York City. Evelyn McHale jumps from the 86th floor of the Empire State Building and lands on the roof of a limousine below. The sound of her bones making impact with metal sends a photography student to the scene. Snap. Despite the fall, she remains intact. Snap. Shiny black metal folds around her body like silk sheets. Snap. White gloves, pearls, and crossed ankles. She could easily be asleep. Snap. The next morning... her face graces a full page of the New York Times. This photo will be christened the most beautiful suicide, as if life's cut short should ever be ranked by beauty. 2016, New York City. I do not turn to the New York Times for a beautiful tragedy, but Facebook or Twitter or Tumblr, a girl with good hair shows off her artfully running mascara, scroll, a gif of that line from that TV show, runs on repeat and hurts over and over again. I bet the writers knew how universal that pain was. I bet I re-binged the entire series on Netflix, and I bet you did too, scroll. Reblog if you have more scars than friends. And someone reblogs, hoping to make friends, instead of talking about their scars. It's not hard to find hurt here. It's not difficult to push anyone toward the edge, and what could be worse than an early death? Well, the romanticization of it, the presentation of it as a valid option, one that's no longer hiding in hushed-tone family histories or rewritten obituaries, but screamed everywhere with ease. I could buy a snapback with block text that spells out suicide, or shirt that turns dead friend into punchline, or novel that ends with a gun, or brisk walk into calm sea, or peaceful lie, or poisonous seed. The words tragic and beauty do not belong in the same phrasing, yet we keep pairing them together like two young star-crossed lovers, neither of which deserve to die. Hey, Bill, why'd they have to die? Hey, Sylvia, why'd you have to die? Hey, Ernest, hey, Heath, hey, Robin, hey, great, intelligent, beautiful heroes, why'd you have to die? They say your genius led you to it. Were your eyes just more open than ours? What did you see? Did you see Evelyn fall? Did you see how fast she went? Not like a shooting star streaking across windows either, but like a body falling off a building, because that's what happened. And though she was found intact, she was so broken, standing on that ledge, looking down, most likely not thinking about how pretty she would look on the ground.
Amazing.
Thank you very much. Has a Shakespeare reference in it, so that's why I thought I'd include
definitely,
it.
Thank you for sharing.
That's yes. Deep.
Yeah, very.
That's real deep.
Thank you.
Thank you for joining us for another episode of Literary Gladiators. For now, keep
reading. Oh, you beat me to it.